things to be seen. One is
all this for our own problem or for the problem that is being presented?
Not your problem, others' problem.
This is for others' problem.
Your problem, others will give their comments.
Okay.
Right?
In case of theoretical analysis, the information is
not
there.
Now, implementation does not, if it is not there, it can be something to
read it for.
Right? And you note down somewhere all these points, otherwise, tomorrow again.
So today we'll be presenting parallel clustering algorithms. We'll be dealing with hierarchical and fuzzy clustering, both its implementation and experience. So before going into details, let me give you an overview of what the presentation will be. First, we will deal with hierarchical clustering, the different metrics, then the sequential version. We will start off with the naive sequential version and then with the efficient one, and then the parallel version, and then the results and analysis, and similar for the fuzzy clustering. And we will end up with the demo. So before going into hierarchical clustering and fuzzy clustering, first we must have an idea of what clustering is. So clustering mainly divides a set of data points into groups, and it divides it in such a way such that every group has similar type of elements, and every and whenever we compare elements from different groups, they have different they are much dissimilar. And it can also be viewed as a data compression, because now every element of a every cluster can be viewed as a single data point, because every other point is similar to.
Okay, so one of the important clustering technique is hierarchical clustering. So idea here is to begin with, we start taking as all endpoints as a single clusters with single elements, and we iteratively merge two closest clusters to each other. So, eventually we combine all points in a single cluster that is called as a dendrogram. So, when considering distance between two clusters, so there are many ways to define it. In general, the classification is graph matrix and geometrical matrix. So graph matrix use technique as a single link. For example, single link defines distance between two cluster as a distance between pair of points, each point belonging to one cluster, and such that the distance is minimum. Similarly, average link is distance between average of distance between all the pairs. Complete link is the maximum edge between such that one point is in one cluster and another is another. Geometrical matrix, centroid is centroid of all the points in the cluster, so you measure distance from centroid. And median is so while merging two clusters, we take a median of two previous clusters as a center of the new cluster.
So here just an example is there. We have five data points, and initially we start off with every data point in a single cluster. And then we have also shown here the dendrogram out here. So it initially at the first level, it was seen that the cluster 1 and cluster 2, both containing only one points, they are the closest to each other. So at the first level, we are having combining these two. And at the second level, then we are after combining this, we find that 4 and 5 are the closest, next closest. So at this level, second level, we are combining this 4 and 5. And then iteratively, we do this. And now, say we need, we are after doing this, we need k number of clusters. So we have to cut this tree into at a certain level. Now if we cut this at this level, we get 5 clusters. If we cut it at this level, we get 4 clusters with 1 with 2. And similarly, if we do it at the top level, we have only 1 cluster. So before going, we have to understand what the data structure is. So first, the only thing we need here is the distance between the every data points. So for doing this, we need this array of two-dimensional array which maintains the distance between all the data points. And for doing this, we only need the upper or the lower triangular matrix because the other half will be a copy of the same thing. And the computing this array requires order n squared time.
So here is a basic algorithm. We compute in first step the matrix Dij. This will take n squared time. And for we fix a number of clusters a priori, that is k, and we do iteration n minus k times to obtain k clusters. So in each iteration, we obtain two closest clusters. We merge them and update the distance matrix.
So in this this part takes order n squared time. And again, in doing this, means finding the minimum, we have to find all the scan all these elements of D. So this is also requires order n squared time. And again, updating requires order n squared time. So overall, this this step two takes order n cubed time.
This can be a bit improved with additional data structure. So we maintain a list of near elements. So for each element, we maintain element or cluster closest to that. So to begin with, near is an area of size n, and near I is a point index of point closest to I. So computing near will take n squared time, and using near we can obtain the two nearest clusters in order n time, because we have to find a pair which is closest to each other. So obviously that will belong, it will be one of these, because this is list of for each point, the closest point is there in the near array. So the closest pair will, can be found out in near array in order n time.
So if this is the array, means D array, and we have the near array now. So after having the near array, means initially we were doing all this scan to find the minimum. To find the minimum, we were looking all this value of D. Now, since we know that the, for the first cluster, the near is second, so we will only look into this value, because we know that in the entire row, this is the minimum. And in every row, we will only look at the minimum value. If this is 2, this is 3, say 1 and 2. So we will only look into these values. So this comes out to be order n. Now finding the minimum. Yes. In this part, this will be done in order n time. And now, this is the SAN property. So SAN stands for the same agglomerative nearest neighbor. Now, it means that whenever, say, we are merging these clusters A and B.
CS102, I have given you the right key.
So when say we are merging A and B, so now the nearest neighbor of C and D is changed to the new. Means if say for C it was nearest neighbor was A, now it will be the combined one. For D also it will be the same combined one, and for others it remains the same. So updating the near takes now order n time, because now we have whatever clusters we are merging, we will just look into if it is equal to A or B, and if it is equal to any of them, then we are assigning the combined one. And then we have the reducibility property. The reducibility property is that if you say these are the distances, and with some distance say rho, and then we are merging I and J. So the distance between the combined one and the other cluster K will be greater than rho. So this is, so if we are taking a centroid as the minimum, metric, say these are the points we are merging. So this, say this is the kth point, this is I, this is j. So after merging this, the centroid will come up somewhere here. So this distance is actually, if this is greater than rho, this is greater than rho, so this may be less than rho. But since we are using this single link metric, so this property is also there, so that because this will be either closest, we are considering only between points. Say these are the clusters, this is the cluster, and we have another cluster, say this. So the distance is between, we are taking all the points, distances between pair of points at this point, this distance, every possible combination, and we are taking the minimum. So so it will come out something like this. And if we are considering this metric, this property holds, the single link.
No, but in the worst case, what happens then? This, the distance between this point and that point will be very high.
Yes, sir.
And then also,
but in higher, in using single link, we are just considering means, if it is, say, this is the point and this is the whole cluster, then in the next level, we will be merging this, even if the other point is far away from it.
Now, in that case, we are not making any mistake, right? In detecting the cluster. I don't know. Let us see.
And so, in doing.
So, this is an improved sequential algorithm. So we use those properties to update near and distance metrics. So previously these two steps were n square, now they are n. So so overall is n square, complexity is n square. So parallel version, first step is computing dij. Now computation of dij is independent of is an independent operation, so can be divided across processors. So we divide n elements into p groups, where p is number of processors, and each processor will calculate its share of the matrix. So this will take n square by p time. Then we'll compute near I. Again, here we can divide the data across processors. Again, this will reduce by a factor of p. In sequential, this is order n. Again, this is an independent operation. We divide it across p processors. This get reduced by p. And same is the case with updating d and p after merging, near after merging. So the complexity is now n squared by p overall.
In actually, in every the matrix is divided into this row wise, block row, and every processor computes its own part.
In that case, you are assuming that you have a shared memory,
yes,
environment,
yes, sir,
and all the things are available in the global memory,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And is there any possibility? There is no possibility. No concurrent read will be coming. Concurrent read is there, right?
Concurrent read is there.
Because right, otherwise, how can I use that? Okay.
So we have implemented it on a 4 processor machine, we Intellium 64 processors. So
this was the result, means using 1000 data set size, we were getting this, and whenever the data set size was increased, we were getting around the gain of p. With 5000, we were getting around 3.84 for 4 processors.
So for a larger data set, it is better to parallelize because the results here are not so good, because this number.
The only thing is that your data set is an integer.
No, so we are using floating point.
Floating point. And how do you.
We use random numbers. Just.
And that is. In reality. And another thing is that means it is a 4 processor, you are gaining it by a factor of 4.
Yeah.
So speed up is what?
So this is the speed up.
Speed up is
sequential time
by the
value time. Okay, so next clustering technique is fuzzy clustering. In hierarchical clustering, either a member belongs to a given cluster or not. So here it is. There is a notion of membership to each cluster, and the membership varies in degree. So for each point, it belongs to all the clusters that we want, but it will fractionally belong to the cluster such that the membership value for each, sum of the membership for every cluster is 1. That is, we store it in a normalized way. So we have n points, so we maintain n by k matrix. So for each point, it ij is the value of membership for that particular point to that particular cluster.
And sum of row will be?
And sum of membership to each cluster is 1.
So this will be the objective function. Mainly we are trying to minimize this sum of the distances when we are considering the distance with the corresponding cluster to which it belongs, and this is the first, this membership degree. And with the membership degree, changing the membership degree, we can actually change the fuzziness to crisp cluster. And this is the iterative formula from which the cluster center can be calculated from the values of the partition matrix and the vice versa, from partition matrix to WI.
So here is basic sequential algorithm for FCM. We initialize partition matrix, then we update center of the coordinates. These three steps are iterative. We update center coordinates, and according to that we again update partition matrix, and after each iteration the previous partition matrix and current partition matrix is compared, and if the difference is below threshold we stop iterating, if it is above threshold we go again and iterate. Now for this, as I said before, we decide the number of clusters a priori. So it may be that the number is not appropriate for that data. So we need some metrics to evaluate the quality of clustering that we have got. So there are different algorithms that gives us index value depicting, the telling what is the quality of clustering. So out of that we are using a PBEM index. So the index value is calculated as follows. This is the formula. Where k is the number of clusters that we want to have. E1 is the sum of distances from the geometric centers of all samples. So this can be considered as a expression for considering entire set of point as a single cluster, and this is for each individual cluster of that, the same distance for set of points. DK is the maximum separation of each pair of clusters. So we after partitioning we calculate a value of this. So we start with different values of k, and for each value of k we calculate the value of the index, and for which value for the value where we get the maximum value of index, we assume that that number is most appropriate for clustering of data.
And these are the formula which are used for calculating E1, EK and DK. This is as said, it was the take the entire data set is taken as one cluster and the distances are taken. Here it is taken into k clusters, and dk is the maximum separation between clusters. And then the entire procedure can be summarized as this: first selecting the maximum number of clusters, and then because E1 is, we can compute, it is independent of the number of clusters, so we compute in advance, and then we run this for various values of k. First the FCM algorithm, then we compute EK, DK and then PBMK. And after doing this, we find what is the maximum value of this PVMK. And after that, whatever this the maximum value is, we consider that to be the appropriate number of clusters.
And so here is parallel version of FCM. Again, the operations are pretty much independent. So we divide to calculate partition matrix. Again, we divide into P groups, and each processor will work on n by P rows of the partition matrix. Then to calculate center coordinates, again we divide into p groups. So this is iterative procedure. To update partition matrix, again we divide into p groups. Now to calculate difference between old partition matrix and new partition matrix, principle is applicable here also. We again divide data into FP groups and calculate the difference. So to calculate the index values, we need these three expressions. This is independent for each point we have. So over n, again division in p sets, ek is for each point and for each cluster. So this loop we can divide it into n sets.
So we are doing this outer summation as for the first processor from 1 to n by p, from the second processor to n by p to n by p plus 1 to 2 n by p, and similarly in EK also the outer loop is divided.
To calculate maximum distance among the clusters, so we have around k square pairs. So if we divide it into k square by p, and each will calculate its local value of maximum, and after that it all the local values of maximum are sequentially merged to get a global maximum.
The entire parallel algorithm, now we can do this part in parallel computing the E1, and then as said earlier, the FCM algorithm can be run in parallel, and this we can calculate EK and DK in parallel, and then this can be this is done sequentially, and this take constant and just a multiplication, and then we find the maximum of PBMK, and that cluster will be the. And in this case, we got this result. For 100, we are not getting much gain, but for 10,000 data set size, we are getting around the same thing. So for simplicity, we have taken this 16 points, around 1, 1, 1, and other 10, 10, 11, and 5, 3, 4, and 18, 18, 6. And for that, so this is the output file, and we are getting this four clusters from here. All the data points are.
So change the data. Take the same data.
Okay.
Only
parallel,
one or two.
Parallel
data, CD parallel. 28. Where is your 18? 18. I'm not seeing. Make 10.1 is there, right?
Yeah, this one.
You make it 18.1.
18.1. Rest.
So 18.1 will be increased, right?
Yeah.
Also your timetable is not matching,
so this is what we got. Actually the second and the third coordinate are not similar, so it is 18 18 18. We are getting 18 18 6, we are getting one cluster, and here we are getting a separate cluster, and these are taken as a one cluster.
Why cluster 2 and cluster 4 is that?
So second dimension and the third dimension are much
different.
It's 10.3, 11.1, and here it is 18.3 and 6.6. And they are much closer. These two clusters were much closer. 1.1.1 and 5.3.4 were much closer than that. So if we change that.
Thank you. You have to try, you have to retain only your written
Q exclamation.
Do it fully.
This
18.1, 16.29.
Okay,
anyway, you show the other one.
So for 1000 data set size and this is the time taken for this in microseconds for taking as a one processor, and now if you take it as two.
Okay.
This was the time taken, almost reduced by half. And for say four. This is for data set size equal to 1000.
But EK is. What is EK? EK gives you the distance, right?
No, PVM is
EK was the factor in PVM. EK and DK. E1 was constant for all. So initially it was before going into the FCM loop. Initially E1 was calculated at the initial part. This is the E1 is equal to 15.2665 1.5, and then for each value of K, this EK, DK and PVM were calculated, and this finally the with the highest PVM is it was 1.93 for K equal to 2, then for 6 it was 1.8, 9 it was 1.5, so maximum was for 2. So it was giving this for k equal to 2, and this was the time taken 4.0.
No, tell me. Okay. This is over, right? Your presentation?
Sir, our presentation is about parallelizing FFT. The basic DFT, discrete Fourier transform, has a lot of applications, like in signal processing and its related fields, to solve partial differential equations, or for multiplying large integers, or to perform various operations and convolutions. Here, the main this thing with DFT is that each of these DFTs get called a lot, so we should try to optimize it as much as possible. This is the basic DFT formula, where you have Bj is equal to, this is your data set, and that is the complex variables, and then you multiply it to get Bj. And here you have FFT. FFT is actually very simple. Basically, instead of using the whole data set, you divide it into odd and even, and then you use the odd terms to even terms to multiply to the even terms in a data set, and the odd complex ones to odd a terms. And then here we have the sequential FFT algorithm. This is basically very simple. Here there it just happens to have a sort of recursion here, where you send all your odd terms here, even terms here, and odd terms here. This will take up of n log n time, So we have been trying to parallelize this. This is the basic parallelizing algorithm for mesh connected network. Here you have, if you have like 16 processes and you have a data set of size 16, then you have four on the rows and four on the columns, and these things will be connected in a mesh. This is the basic algorithm. In the parallel FFT, basically here you'll be just bringing the values to each of these processes. Each processor will have its own value, and then here you will, according to the, here the log n represents the row or the column. Basically it is like you have 16 data sets, so this becomes 4, and when you take it here and you multiply it here, the main thing is the main parallelization comes here. Here when you say CK is equal to CK plus CKP, it means that CK will request the value of CK plus P. Okay, and CKP will send the value here. It will do the necessary computation, create a new value of CK plus P, and it will send it back. So basically there is a send from CK plus P, a receive from CK, and again there is a send from CK, and the CK plus P will receive its new value here. And then you have the last step where there is a small computation of R of K, which is basically reversing the bits you have, like 4 becomes 12. So it's like basically just reversing the bits. For step 1 takes constant time, basically it's just like assigning values, so that takes constant time. And step 2 will take you a lot of routing and computational steps, which we will come to it. And this one, step 3 contains only routing.
Okay. Step 1 will take only constant time, step 2 consists of computational as well as routing operations. So we can see that there are fixed number of computational operations, out of which this exponentiation is the most time consuming. And it will take order of log n time. And as the loop iterates for log n time, the computational will take.
But what is P?
P is just equal to. We are calculating it here, 2 power h. H you get from the loop, and P is equal to 2 power h, that's all. All this computation is pretty straightforward here. It's only this part you have to understand. That's all.
Computational will take order of log square n time. Now come to the routing part. Here, as Harsha told, that every processor with index k will send value to other processor having index k plus p, and it will also receive value from it. Now we will take back here. We will take an example with 16 processors where value h will initialize to 3, and p will be therefore at. Now routing, here the value of h equal to 3, therefore 3 equal to 8. Now routing will take place between processors with index differ by 8.
So basically P0, the routing will take place between the first row and the third row. That is, P0 will talk to P8, P1 will talk to P9, P2 will talk to P10, and P4 will talk to P12. Basically what the first perception of anybody would be that, you know, this routing should be very simple, we can do it. But when you're doing in PVM, this becomes very complicated. I'll show you later. The importance of this thing is we have tried to calculate like what, how many steps take place in each of these iterations. So this is the first iteration where you will take from P0 to P8 and P4 to P12. And in the second iteration,
the value of h is 2 and p equal to 4. So routing will take place with the processor differing in index 4.
So, and in the third iteration you have this. Now you are now this will take place in the same row. So routing becomes a bit more easier actually. It will go from here to here and P1 to P3. At the same way, P4 to P6 and P5 to P7.
Well, what do you mean by routing becomes very
easier? Sir, actually I'll tell you, when PVM comes, the routing from one row to another, it becomes a bit more easier. Because for example, if you want to bring from P3 to like P8, you have to come from here.
No, we are routing here from this to this.
No, that is okay. I am just giving an example, for example.
P0 to P8.
P0 to P8 is simple. You just come from here to here.
But you told that here only row wise.
Here also it will come from P1 to P2.
Achha, theek
hai. Chalo. In last iteration, value of h is 0, so routing will take place between these processors. So this routing process can be represented by this expression. Here 2 to the power s equal to root n, and multiplied by 2 because each processor is sending as well as receiving value. therefore time taken by this routing, whole routing process will be order of
10 minus 2.
In step 3, we are sending as well as receiving value to the processor whose index is reverse of itself. Now we will see this by a simple example. Here one thing we can notice that the processor in row 1 are sending value to processor in column 1. Second row will send value to this column. Third row will send to this column. So we will send these element via this processor P0, P6, P15 and P9.
Here what happens is P0, the reverse of P0 is P0 itself, so it doesn't have to send. And the reverse of P6 is P6 itself. So when you are sending it, we created a route which says that it will go first from all the values from row 1 will go here, and only then they will go here. In the same way here, what happens is the values from P4 to P5 will go here, and then they will make a decision whether to go down or upwards. P7 has to go to 14, so P7 will go down like this. So this is like a much better approach of doing it when you are doing it with an algorithm. Even if you take it to a 64 mesh, this thing, this will become very easy for you. And this will be the second iteration in that.
Second time you will receive those values because each processor is sending as well to receiving value. So we can see that the maximum distance between any two processors here is 2 into root n minus 1 between this and this. So order of this routing step is 2 into root n minus 1. Therefore here we saw that routing dominates the computational time, therefore the
we wanted to mainly optimize the routing in this, in the mesh FFT. So
the whole routing will take order of root n time, and therefore complexity of algorithm is order of root n. Number of processors used here is n, cost is order of n to power 3 by 2, speed up we are achieving here is order of root n log n, and efficiency log n by root. Now come to the modified model. Here we are using n processors P0 to Pn minus 1. Here every processor PI is connected.
This is a model we created, sir, completely.
Here PI is connected to PJ where I and J differ by 1, 2, 4 up to n by 2. Means index differ by power of 2. And case 2 is where index is reverse of itself. So the model will look like this. Here the index of P2 is reverse of P4. So it is shown by these red edges.
So these red edges are basically for step 3 and these black edges are for step 2. So basically you are really maximizing the number of connections you will have, and you are looking at which possible connection will be used, and you are adding that connection. So instead of having a whole mesh, this will be much easier to use for.
And so one point we can note that we have removed these connections from mesh, and this also.
And also here, there are no connections here.
So now we will count the number of connections we used here. Number of connection in one column is root n by 2 log n. We can see this by an example. In one column, there are root n by 2 connections like this. Next, root n by 2 connection like this. And like this. Root n by
so this two. Is basically so when the root n for each of the h values. This is for the first iteration of h, second iteration of h, third iteration of h.
Correct.
So log root n times root n by 2. And there are root n columns, therefore so total n by 2 log root n.
Same thing actually will be there.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next. Similarly, we will do for rows. Next. So number of connection in all columns will be this. Similarly for each row we will do connection, and therefore total number of connection for case 1 is n log 2.
Case 1 is the step 2, the main computation step that we are using from CK plus P to CK, and again the reverse direction. That will take you n log of root n. And
no, but every processor is having fixed number of connections.
Yes sir, fixed number of connections.
What is the number of value?
Sir, we are counting this. In case 2, next figure. We can see that root and processors are there who don't need connection for step 3 because the index of 6, 9, 15 are reverse of itself. But so therefore root and connection processor do not require any connection. So the remaining n minus root n processor require only n minus root n by 2 connection for step 3. Therefore total number of connections will be n minus root n by 2 plus n log root n, while number of connections in mesh network is 2 into n minus root n.
No, but for your case, some processor is having less number of connections, some processor is having more number of connections, agree?
No, not.
Say go to this one. Say P10 is having how many connections?
P10. P10 will have like 1, 2, 3, and 4.
Five.
Yeah,
5.
The same P0 will also have 5 connections. P8 will also have 5 connections. P2 will have 5 connections.
P0 has 4 connections.
Yeah, P0, okay. There is nothing this side, so it will have 4 connections.
Different for some processor.
Huh? But there is a pattern actually. We can decide from that.
P9 is having 4, right?
P9 is having, yeah, 4. P9, it will have 4 because P9 is the reverse of itself.
I'm not justifying.
Okay.
Your point is that P9 is having 4, P10 is having 5.
Yeah.
Right? So, can you have a formula for that?
Yeah, we do have a formula. We just didn't put it up.
Because
when you write an algorithm, we need a formula like this to actually use it out.
Sir, here we need one less connection because it is reverse of itself. So and these processors have
see that is you need less connection is different. But point is that if you want to fabricate it, then you need.
Yeah, I get it, sir.
So proper formula.
Yes, sir. Yeah. So if you pass the index, we should know the number of connections it will have and which connections it will have. Yeah.
That formula. You
yes.
Now we come to the analysis of this model. We are using the same algorithm here. So step 1 will take constant time, step 2 consists of routing and computational operation, step 3 consists of routing operation only. So computational operation similar to mesh network take order of log squared time. Step 2 routing will take constant time and loop iterates for log n time, therefore order of log n time for step 2. And for step 3 constant time is for routing operation. So time complexity of algorithm is order of log squared n time because here the computation is dominating the routine. So overall running time of algorithm log square n, number of processors n, cost is order of n log square n, which is not optimal. And we are achieving speed up of order of n by log n and efficiency order of n by log n. So advantage here is that it gives better performance and routing is very simple. We are just.
You already know which processor you will be sending to, so the routing happens directly. There are no hops actually. It's just one connection.
And this advantage. More number of connections.
We have more number of connections compared to the mesh network, and also it is far more complicated. Like the mesh network, you know exactly where it is going. So implementation we did it in PVM. PVM basically it provides a layer of abstraction using. Without the user worrying about the underlying hardware, and all the heterogeneous systems can be connected to a single PVM, and PVM will give a certain abstraction of which a certain abstraction that all these machines will be using the same data formats and stuff. It also handles the routing, the data conversion, task scheduling across the network. The user just writes his application as a collection of tasks and spawns it on various systems irrespective of the hardware. Whereas even if they are heterogeneous systems, virtual machine will, the PVM will actually give you sort of an abstraction layer where you will say all the systems have some common. It can connect to different types of hosts in a single session. It uses a certain variable called the task ID, which is used to identify the host that is connected to the VM. Tasks can compose and send messages arbitrary size containing type of data. That is, you can define initially that I will be sending an int at this instant or a float at this instant. The implementation of parallel FFT, the process spawned on all the hosts will be connected to the virtual machine basically, and follows the first algorithm we implemented followed the mesh this thing, and there is no interrupt driven receive. So this is one of the main drawbacks of PVM. Like for example, in a processor you have spawned a thread and it is running, and if you want to like have, and if you don't know exactly when on which processor what value will be coming and where it has to be forwarded, the problem with blocking receive is that it will give you an infinite loop, and the problem with non-blocking receive is that you have to keep constantly checking. Instead, if you have something like an interrupt driven receive, where whenever I receive a value, the program will just say that okay, I have received an interrupt, I will go and handle it and then I can come back to my computation. That would have been much better, but PVM does not provide that, and that is the reason why we had to go through all the computation of the routing, like how many we had to go and all that. We did it in CC, sir, using 16 machines.
What's 16 machines?
Linux lab.
What is the performance you have seen?
Sir, performance, the problem is measuring on PVM, what I had to do was I had to create a master thread which spawns these things, and from that I had to take, because each of these machines have their own clocks. So that actually what I meant is the first algorithm came out an average of 32 microseconds and the second one came out 24 microseconds.
What is the data size?
Data size 60.
But you cannot cluster, partition the whole things into block by block?
So that we have not done. That becomes a completely different algorithm. That it does not become this.
Because generally, FFT size is, matrix size is very large.
Yeah, we know that, but
for
this
small
algorithm.
Size, suppose matrix multiplied by simple number multiplication. If its number is small, why shall I use FFT?
Yeah.
But
in this algorithm, actually, we don't use that part, where you have a certain array in each of the processes.
So, any questions?
We can divide the problem and.
Don't want to disturb him.